From Luke 16, verses 19 through 31. There was a certain rich man who clothed himself in purple and fine linen, and who feasted luxuriously every day. At his gate lay a certain poor man named Lazarus, who was covered with sores. Lazarus longed to eat the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. Instead, the dog would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried by angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. While being tormented in the place of the dead, he looked up and saw Abraham at a distance with Lazarus at his side. He shouted, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I'm suffering in this flame." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received good things, whereas Lazarus received terrible things. Now Lazarus is being comforted and you are in great pain. Moreover, a great crevice has been fixed between you and us. Those who wish to cross over from here to you cannot, neither can anyone cross from there to us." The rich man said, "Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house. I had five brothers. He needs to warn them so that they don't come to this place of agony." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They must listen to them." The rich man said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will change their hearts and lives." Abraham said, "If they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, then neither will they be persuaded if someone rises from the dead." The word of God for the people of God.
I love pearly gate stories. There's a fella who found himself at the pearly gates, and St. Peter was there. He said, "Well, I've got some bad news for you. Our computer is down, so we can't let you in. We'll have to have you go on down to hell. And when the time comes, we'll call you back when everything is fixed." And the guy says, "Well, how do I know how to get to hell?" He says, "Well, you go that way, and the land is going to get dry and brown and desiccated, and then you're going to see a fiery glow in the distance. That's where you're going." So the guy headed down that way, but the land did not turn dry and brown and desiccated. It turned flush and green and verdant. And the guy said, "I must have turned the wrong way." He turns around, heads back to St. Peter and says, "What happened? I went that way. It wasn't all dry and desolated. It was green and beautiful." And St. Peter says, "Oh, darn. Those Mormons are irrigating again." I like pearly gate stories because it's not about whether or not you're going to go to heaven. It's about the real issues in our lives, the fears in our lives. And they're brought into high relief in a story about the afterlife. And that's what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with regrets. We all have regrets. We have to make decisions, and the decisions lead to regrets. I've noticed that alcohol and vehicles often lead to regrets. And recently, in the 21st century, it seems to be marijuana and the internet. I just heard of a guy who posted a picture, a very uncomplimentary picture, of himself naked on Facebook, and now it's all over the world. He has some regrets. Our regrets come from our decisions. And we have to make decisions. In fact, one definition of being an adult, of being grown up, is not how old you are. It is that you have made a certain number of irrevocable decisions. Decisions about school, career, marriage, family, and some other decisions that didn't go so well. And we have regrets. Here's a video clip from The Bucket List with Morgan Freeman and Jack Nicholson.
You know, the ancient Egyptians had a beautiful belief about death. When their souls got to the entrance to heaven, the gods asked them two questions. Their answers determined whether they were admitted or not.
Okay. I'll bite.
Have you found joy in your life? Answer the question.
Me?
Yeah,
you. Answer the question. Have I found joy in my life?
Yes.
Yes.
Has your life brought joy to others?
This type of question. I don't know. I don't think about how other people gauge. Ask them.
I'm asking you.
Fine. Let me put it to you this way. After the breakup and the ensuing fleecing of the dad, Emily went to live with her mother. You know, you try to stay close, but it gets down to holidays, phone calls, birthday cards, you know. Anyway, Emily goes to college, joins one of her Save the Poor People, the animals, whatnot. Meets a guy, decides she loves him. Good-looking kid, driven, smart. But there was something about him, so... When she said they were engaged, I told her I was against it, but being my daughter, naturally. She went ahead and married him anyway. Needless to say, I wasn't invited to the wedding.
That must have hurt.
You think? First time he hit her, she came to me. I wanted to bash his brains in. She wouldn't let me. Said she loved him, said it wasn't his fault. He'd had a few drinks. She was the one picked the fight. Next time it happened, she didn't come to me. The ex told me. Nice to hear her voice again.
What did you do?
What any father would do. I took care of it.
We'll call the rich man dives. That's kind of a tradition because in Latin, the word for rich man is divis, D-I-V-E-S, and it was just translated as dives and became his name in some traditions. Dives is a rich man and he has regrets. He may have been a Sadducee. Now, Sadducees were the priestly class. They dressed in richly dyed robes. They ate sumptuous meals. And they had no use for this Pharisee thing about resurrection or life after death. For them, life was from birth until death. And that's all. And whatever God did, if God blessed you for your goodness or cursed you for your sins, it happened in life. Now, of course, that was easy for the Sadducees because they'd been blessed. They thought the Pharisees were crazy with their resurrection and afterlife and their bosom of Abraham things. So Dives is particularly sorry and surprised when he finds out that God will have justice and the scales will be balanced. And he will be there to regret his life forever. And not just because he's rich. Actually, when it comes to being rich, if you've got clothes on your back, food in the fridge, or a roof and a roof over your head, you are doing better than 75% of the people in the world. If you've got money in the bank, cash in your pocket, or change in a bowl somewhere, you are among the top 8% of the world's wealthy. You are dives. Does this mean you're going to go to hell? No. But it does mean that we must listen to the one who returned to us from death. And he says, pay attention. The way you treat the least of these, the bottom of the barrel, the bums, the vagrants, the people whose lifestyle you do not agree with. The way you treat them is how you're treating me, paying attention. Sharon and I went to New York City years and years ago. Was it 1973? I think it was like that. And we decided to go into a restaurant on Fifth Avenue. And to get in the restaurant, we had to almost literally step over a homeless person there. And once we got into that restaurant, we looked at the menu, and a cup of coffee was $5. And this was when you could go a few blocks over to the automat and get one for a nickel. And it brought to me two realizations about being rich. One is that if you're rich, you like to spend money. You like to have things high priced. It's like that old saying about Neiman Marcus. They never put prices on items at Neiman Marcus. If you had to ask, you couldn't afford it. And the second thing is the rich seem to enjoy stepping over the Lazaruses of this world on their front porch step. Somehow that makes you feel even richer. You see, this is not about being rich. And this is not a regret of something Dives did. It is a regret of the way Dives lived and his vision of the world. He did not seek Lazarus. I'm worried about our country right now. Congress has or is in the process of defunding what we used to call food stamps. It's now called SNAP. It is food for the poor. $30 billion is being removed from that program. And it's going to cause two things. One, there will be children who go to bed hungry at night. And two, one person who works at our local grocery store is probably going to lose his job. It's going to change the economy in a subtle way. I am bothered because it seems like our country is now acting like a bunch of blind, rich people. And it's not what Jesus was talking about at all. He's talking about two very simple things that change our life. It's a perspective thing. It's like what the word repent means. It means to turn around. You're pointing the wrong way. You're sinning because you're missing the target. You're missing the point. Turn around, and there is the target. And the clearest way I've ever heard this, we heard for the singer at Ernie and Judy Hammer's End of the Summer Picnic. He sang a song called The Gospel According to Luke. So I looked it up on the internet, on YouTube, and here it is.
He was an old hand at living and making his way. He smelled like old whiskey and he needed a shave. His home was an alley off 8th Avenue. And if you had a minute for an hour or two, he'd tell you the gospel according to Luke. And Luke carried his Bible in a crown royal bag, and he wiped off his brow with an old dirty rag. He'd tell you straight out just the way he believed. His faith in the good Lord is all that you need. I remember the morning he first preached to me. He said, give to your brother if he is in need. Offer up thanks for the gifts you receive. There's treasure in heaven for the generous give. That was the gospel according to God. So I bought him breakfast at the Daylight Cafe. Biscuits and gravy, hot coffee and eggs. He was hungry and ragged, hadn't eaten in days. But I was the one there who felt out of place. He folded his hands, bowed his head, and said grace. Then a week ago Wednesday, I saw him again. Downtown at the mission, surrounded by friends, handing out all the change he'd collected that week, saying you boys might need this a lot more than me. I tried hard to practice the words that I preach. Give to your brother if he is in need. Offer up thanks for the gifts you receive. There's treasure in heaven for the generous few. That was the gospel according to Luke. He was an old hand at living and making his way. He smelled like old whiskey and he needed a shave. His home was an alley off 8th Avenue. And if you had a minute or an hour or two, he'd tell you the gospel according to Luke.
Got another pearly gate joke for you. Fellow wound up at pearly gates. St. Peter handed him a piece of chalk. Said, that stairway over there, that's the stairs to God's throne. Now, as you go up those stairs, you're to write down one of your sins on each step. So the guy took the chalk, got down on his knees, started working his way up the steps, had gone for some time, and suddenly he sees somebody coming down, and it's his local priest. He says, Father, it's so good to see you. I haven't seen you since you passed away a week ago. And he said, have you seen God? And the priest said, no, I ran out of chalk. And the guy, there's an addendum to that joke. The guy cried out, oh, Jesus, save me. And just then Christ was by his side. He says, come on, give me that chalk, come on. And they went down the stairs. As they're walking around a corner, Jesus says, you confessed your sins while you were alive. And quite frankly, I've forgotten them all. Why don't you just take the elevator? That's the good news.